Okay, today we are going to discuss about one of the major short stories in your English literature syllabus, which is actually taken as a part of a book, or else we call that an extract, and it is Vevu by Sonali Dharaniyagala. So if you take basically the four short stories that we have two stories actually. If you take Sangakkara's story, it is actually a part of a speech, right? It is also an extract. And if you take this one, it is also an extract from the original book called Vevu. And if you take both short stories are real life incidents. Apart from the other two, we can't exactly say that those are real life incidents, but these two short stories are real life incidents, and the author or the speaker is explaining about the real life incidents. So extract from Vevu by Sonali Dharaniyagala is actually taken from her book Vevu, which is written by herself, and she has included all the traumatic experience that she went through in her life after the tsunami, and soon after she lost her family members. So all the traumatic experience and her pain and agony has been included in this story. So there are certain important emotional incidents also mentioned by her in a very tragic way. So we will going to discuss about those things as well. And I hope to discuss all the literary techniques behind this, as well as some target questions. So we will move on. As you can see on the screen, Sonali Dharaniyagala is a Sri Lankan who worked and married and lived in England, an economist by profession. She married Steve Lisenberg, a research professor, and had two sons, Vikram and Malli. In 2004, the Lisenbergs came to Sri Lanka on holiday. On 26th of December, they were caught in the devastating tsunami which swept over southern part of Sri Lanka. They were in a hotel in Yala, which was overrun by the fateful tidal wave. Sonali lost her husband, her two young sons, and her parents. She was herself badly injured but survived. So this is the basic experience that she went through, actually. And based on this experience, she had a lot of trauma, or else unimaginable pain, and she always wanted to release that pain. So what she did, she tried to suicide herself, but she survived. And later she thought that all her traumatic experience and pain should be included into some form of literature, and then we have a Vevu by Sonali Dharaniyagala as an example. So this is actually a real experience of the author. It was a highly famous book because she has included almost real incidents, the real experience that she went through, her real emotions, she has included there in the book. So make sure to remember, she herself tried to suicide several times, and she didn't become successful on that. And after that, she thought, I should include all this experience into a book. So she decided to write this book. So actually, if you take the scenario, this is based on 26th of December, where all the family members, including her parents, including her two sons and husband, as well as some family friends like Orlanta, Behula, and Anton, their family also joined this, family trip in Yala. And then they had to face some kind of unfortunate incident here. The disaster occurred on the same day, and how they reacted, how she reacted, and what kind of consequences that she had to face because of this incident, all these things are explained here in this extract. She was herself badly injured but survived. For a long time, she could not accept the truth of her loss and attempted several times to kill herself, as I have explained. So if you are comparing with the other short stories that we have, this one is kind of an original one, because we can clearly explain that she herself tried to suicide herself because she could not bear the pain, bear the torment. And later on, she decided to put that into a book. So as a result, we have Vevu. But her watchful relations prevented her from harming herself. After about 3 years, she went to her home in London, where objects used by her husband and sons and memory persuaded her to accept the truth of her loss. Sonali now lives in New York and works as a visiting lecturer at the University of Columbia. Where is her memoir regarding recording the events of the fateful December 26th? It brings back her pain and agony. It is a living testimony of the horror of tsunami and of a human suffering and endurance, right? Under the themes, we are going to discuss about that. What is human suffering? What is endurance? What is resilience? And how these type of themes are brought by the author inside the story. So these things we are going to discuss further when we discuss about the story. I have the mindset that since because you are in grade 11, you have read the book. So there is no point of explaining the lesson to you again, because I am under the impression that you have already read the book. So you know the story, what happens. So I highly suggest that to read the whole book if you don't have, if you have enough time, because it will give you a fully understanding about the certain incident which occurred there. So it is better that you can read the full book, because it is not a huge book. It clearly explains about the real traumatic experience of the tsunami which affected for Sri Lanka in a very negative manner. The extract takes the reader from the sudden, unexpected, awesome sighting of tsunami to the moment of her consciousness after the vehicle in which she and others were trying to flee overturned, and she was left battered and alone. What she witnessed at the beginning was the white curl of a big wave. The narrative is a second by second observation and report of the horror created by an undersea quake near the Aceh Island close to Indonesia, which killed more than 200,000 people, right? So this is the scenario. It is not only affected for Sri Lanka, but also almost all the other Asian countries who are in Asian continent, each and everyone suffocated from this incident. It is known as one of the most tragic natural disasters which occurred to our country for the first time, because none of the Sri Lankans had first time experience when they experienced this. So that is why a lot of people died. Even the meteorological department even didn't have any idea what you mean by this. Even the word tsunami comes from Japan. So we didn't have any idea about this, even though we have heard about this kind of incidents in our history, in our Buddhism, in our Buddhist history and culture, even though we have heard certain stories like this, but we have not experienced this by ourselves. So this is the first time experience for most of the people, and they never knew that ocean can do such kind of disaster for the human property and human lives, right? So the full incident is there. The whole story based on how they lived in the room together, and at that time how Sonali noticed there was some kind of change happening in the ocean, and later how she ran away, how she flee with her sons, and for a certain time period she thought that she survived, but unfortunately again she again the jeep that they went on tumbled, and they had to face the challenge again. At the end of the day, she explains in the last paragraph what kind of pain and agony that came to her mind. And later, if you read the full story, she explains about how she finds the dead bodies of her children and husband and the family members, and what kind of trauma that brought to her, right? All the explanation is there in the original book, but in your extract it stops where she undergoes the pain and agony at the last moment when the jeep tumbled over, right? So that is the basic idea of the author and the incident, or else we call the experience. Now, when you are writing a story, when you are referring to a story, or when you are writing an answer for a short story, basically, you have to have the experience, right? So experience can be, normally for a writer or an author, experience is known as something specially, what you call fundamental, right? Now, why I say experience is something fundamental, because based on that experience only, that author writes, or else gives the idea, or else the form of literature to the audience. So experience can come to us in two different ways. Sometimes your friend might have got the experience, and he or she may come to you and explain the experience. So based on that, you may write a story, you may write a poem, you may write a novel, or else a short story. But here, the other part is that your personal experience. So if you are writing a personal experience, you are the person who experienced that. So your power of writing is so much bigger than the other one. So here we can clearly understand that she herself experienced this, and we can clearly see the truth that she truthful experience that she included in this short story, which will be very important to us when we are comparing the other short stories, especially like Lumber Room and Nightingale and the Rose by Oscar Wilde, right? Kind of a fairy tale stories. But here we can see the real reality of the short story, where she include each and every detail which really happened there, and what kind of emotions that she went through in this incident, without giving any exaggerated ideas, So that is very important to us children. So we will move on to an introduction to the story. In the extract given in the anthology, the exact moment that she caught into the waves has been described. So from there only, we stop the short story, or else the story, or else the extract. Daroniagala begins her story by describing the morning of the tsunami. She, her family, and her parents were staying at the Yala Safari Beach Hotel. Daroniagala describes the horror on her husband's face just before the tsunami flipped the jeep in which they were trying to outrun the strangeness they had noticed in the ocean. Daroniagala was carried along with the churning water until she managed to grab onto a branch. This branch kept her from being swept out to the ocean in the receding waters. Actually, this branch only helped her to survive, where Molly, Vicky, and Vic and Steve were not that much fortunate to live, where Sonali had certain chance to survive herself because she held into that branch and she survived herself. Right, that was the basic idea about the story. So she was the only survivor from all the family members of herself and the family friends. So she decides to put all this experience into a book, and we have that story here. So so the basic experience, based on the basic experience, I would like to show, I would like to draw your attention towards the literary techniques, right? So when you are having a short story, basically we have literary techniques. It can be a novel, it can be a short story. Basically, we have literary techniques. When it comes to poetry, we basically have poetic techniques. But there are certain differences when we come to poetic techniques and the literary techniques, right? So certain changes can be seen there. So first one is the narrator's point of view. Now, when we come to point of view, when you are writing a short story or when you are writing a novel, basically the writer or the author should have a point of view. In whose point of view I'm going to write this? So basically we have three point of views in literature. It is something very similar to Sinhala literature as well. So point of view can be first person point of view, second person point of view, or third person point of view. So if you are starting your story using I and we, right, or else we call the first person, what do you call, pronouns, you can use, we call that this first person narrative form. Now here you can see the first person narrative form. It is very much positive if you are starting a story in first person narrative form, because you are so much free. Right. Even the audience know that you are the person who is explaining the story. So all the power is with your hand. But when you are shifting to another person, you have to think from that person's perspective and explain the story. Actual real will not be there. Actual real you will not be there. Right. I think you can understand. So here, why this short story actually feels a lot, right, affects us a lot, because of the first person narrative form. Right, we can clearly understand all the visual imageries and auditory imageries are coming to our mind, because Sonali has written this story in a such a way that nobody can argue whether you were there. Actually, she was not there. She was the one who experienced this. Actually, she was the one who writes the story. So no one can argue and no one can debate about that. Right. So first person narrative form has affected a lot for the success of the story. As you can see here on the screen, first person narrative is a point of view who is telling a story, where the story is narrated by one character at a time. This character may be speaking about him or herself, or sharing events that he or she is experiencing, as I have explained to you. First person can be recognized by the use of I or we. So in your story, continuously, if you are using these two pronouns, personal pronouns, I or we, which comes under the first person narrative form. In first person, we only see the point of view of one character, while this character may share details about others in the story. We are only told what the speaker knows, An author may switch from the character to character, but still use first-person narrative. This way, we may learn about what other characters think and feel, right? But we are still limited in our knowledge because we must rely on what the character shares. Sometimes you can shift to the other characters now. Even though Sonali is explaining the story, sometimes Vic is delivering a dialogue. Sometimes Steve is delivering a dialogue, right? So you can see some people are delivering their dialogues, but they are delivering their dialogues under the impression or under the guidance of the Sonali. So Sonali is the person who explains us, he told like this, Steve told like this, right? So the storyteller will never shift into Steve completely. The storyteller will never shift into Vic completely. She will keep that power into her. She is the person who is explaining the story, but you can shift. But you can shift to the characters and you will come back. So one of the major point literary techniques in the story is first person narration, or else we call first person point of view. If you take some poems also, some poems are taken as narrative poems, right? If you take some poems, they are known as narrative poems. If you take Richard Cory by Edwin Arlington Robinson, it is known as a narrative poem because there is a story, right? So if you have stories, right, sometimes you also have a narrative point of view in stories, poems as well. Then the poem has a storyboard inside the poem. Sometimes some poems, they have a storyboard inside the poem. So sometimes we can use the narrative form as well, right? So that is first person narrative form. We have taken that as a literature technique, a literary technique. So we will move on. Then we come to flashback, which is known as past tense. So what do you mean by flashback? So when it comes to literature, we have two forms, that is called flashback and flash forward. So if you take a flash forward, which means you will be in the present time period and you will think about the incidents that may happen in the future. That may happen in the future. So which is known as flash forward. Flashback means you will be in the present moment and you will think about the actions which already occurred in the past. Right, certain things that you have done in the past, whether you are gullible about them or not, whether you think that you have done some offense, you have done some mistake by going into the past, and you will be thinking about that. But in literature, we call past, anybody's past is a really good place to go and have a look around, but it is not a place to live. Right, most of us try to live in our past, but literature, we say past is a very good place to go and have a visit. You can go there, you can have a visit, you will have wonderful memories, and you should come back. That is past, which is already gone, right? So here, it is a flashback because almost all the incidents are explained in past tense, and you can clearly understand this is a trauma, or else this is an experience that she already had, and later on, after 3 years only, she decides to write this story. So all the actions and all the incidents are presented us not in a flash forward, but in a flashback. So when we are explaining flashback, the English tense that we have to use there is past tense. It can be past continuous or past perfect or past perfect continuous. But however, it belongs to past tense, right? So that is what we call flashback. You are at the present moment and you think about the incidents which are happening in the past, right? Those are the things that we have to pay our attention. Then that is the second literary technique that I have taken here as a literary technique in this story, Wave by Sonali Dharaniyagala. So we will move on to the next one. Then another literary technique that I have taken here is situational and conversational language. This is also very important. What do you mean by situational and conversational language? Now, I'm pretty sure that when you are learning about poetry, you might have learned about conversational language in the poem when you have two characters. Most of the time they discuss what you call certain things, and the poem goes like a conversation, right? So conversational characteristics can be seen, or else language techniques can be seen. If you take poems like Two's Company, you can see some what you call conversation. And if you take the Kagwa story, you can see the conversation between the skull and the Kagwa and the soldiers, likewise. So conversational language. So here, when you bring situational and conversational language, especially into a story, they should be appropriate. They should be appropriate, and they should be most of the time emotional, right? Now I have taken an example in red color. You can see that quotation on your screen. We did not get Archie and Sia, I yelled to Steve. This made Vikram cry. Steve held on to him, clasping him to the chest. Archie and Sia will be okay. They will come later. They will come, right? Now I have given an explanation here. Check whether you can identify that. Situational language is used to show the trauma and the experience faced by Sonali and other characters. Now, actually, when we learn about the story, when we study about the story, you can clearly understand Sonali is the person who is responsible. She was the person who didn't inform Archie and Sia. Archie and Sia refers to Sonali's parents. She was the one who didn't inform, right? So actually, at the end of the day, she was guilty conscious. She was guilty conscious. That is why she's telling, we didn't get Archie and Sia. We had enough time, but she explains that I didn't do that because I thought that it will make us late, right? The story is in first person narration, but Sonali had used the language technique appropriately for the most emotional moments. For the most emotional moments, the reaction of Sonali and Steve for the above situation is a clear example how they delivered their dialogues profoundly. On one hand, Sonali is mentally fallen. On the other hand, the children, they are also mentally fallen. At that time, right, the conversational language or situational language can be seen where as a person, Steve directly says that with a positive attitude, you should not be afraid about that. We don't know what actually happened, even though we have the idea they died. Sometimes they might come back. Who knows? Sometimes they might be survived, right? So sometimes we will meet them. Likewise, so coming with the positive attitude of Steve as a dialogue, as a character, is also very important to us. So each and every place we can't see situational and conversational language. But if you take the story, in most of the places, right, the situational or the conversational language has been used by the writer as a very powerful literary technique. This is very important, and you should understand that as well as a very powerful literary technique, situational and conversational language. What kind of language that you should use according to the situation, according to the time period, according to the story, whether you can evoke that, emotion within it, right? So those are the basic literary techniques that we discussed until now. So we discussed about first person narration. Then we discussed about situational and conversational language. And then we move on to the other part, the auditory imagery. Auditory imagery. So as you can see on the screen, auditory imagery is a very powerful poetic technique as well as a narrative technique, right? Or else literary technique. In literature, we take this to poetry as well as novels and short stories, right? So auditory imagery refers to, right, with the sound effect of the certain thing, we will get the imagination into our mind, or the mental pictures will be created inside our mind. This is called auditory imagery with the sound effect. So audition means, which always deals with your sound, right? So I have given a simple explanation here for auditory imagery. Check whether you can go through with that. Auditory imagery describes what we hear, from music to noise to pure sight. Auditory imagery may include enjoyable sounds such as beautiful music, bird song, and the voices of chorus. Noises such as the bang of a gun, the sound of a broom moving across the floor, and the sound of broken glass shattering on the hard floor. The lack of noise describing a peaceful calm or eerie silence, right? Sometimes you may think that auditory imagery is always dealing with sound effects. Always make sure to remember, sometimes we don't have sounds at all, right? That is also a kind of a sound, right? Which is called silence, right? Silence also plays an important role. That's why I have explained here, the lack of noise describing a peaceful calm or eerie silence, right? So always don't think that when it comes to auditory imagery, you always have to make noises, sounds. But sometimes, without having any sound, you can make some kind of eerie silence and peaceful, calm environment, or else we call the background, right? These things are very important to you. Now, in this story, as a short story, how the writer has used this, right? Now, I have given the red color example from the extract. I have taken that from the extract as the quotation. Check whether you can go through with this. Our feet were loud, though. I could hear them slamming the ground. Right? This is the place where Sonali and her children ran away soon after identifying there is some kind of mysterious disaster occurring. And they were nervous. They were full of anxiety. So the way they ran was explained here. How? Our feet were loud, though I could hear them slamming the ground. Right? They were really loud. So it clearly explains that how they ran, right? So the when they are running without having their shoes and sandals, a sound effect came to their own sound effect can be heard by themselves. Now I have explained here, with the sound effect and the quick movement of foot, one can clearly realize about the speed and anxiety Boyce and Sonali had to escape from the danger. That much of anxiety, that much of quickness, that much of fast was included in them, and they wanted to escape from that place very quickly. So it is shown to us using the sound effect of the foot, which is slamming the ground, right? Without having any slippers, without having any shoes, they ran away. So sometimes when you are running on a floor, you might have also heard this sound effect, which comes from the from your foot. So this is taken as a very powerful auditory imagery when the audience can realize how fast they kept their foot on the floor and took them. That much of quickness, that much of fast, that much of anxiety was there within them in order to escape from this place. This is called auditory imagery or the sound effect, right? Let's go to another example. This one I have taken from the story as well. I could hear its engine straining, snarling. We can drive through this water, I thought. This was the most unfortunate incident where the Jeep tumbled with Sonali and her children. The Jeep tumbled, right? So what happened? Here I have explained that the sound effect of the Jeep also brings us the imagination that it will no longer work. The words like straining and snarling are very similar to the sound which is generated from a malfunctioned engine. Sometimes you might have seen, if you have a vehicle, sometimes when you put the key and when you try to start, it will give a certain sound and it will stop. The sound effect is very similar to snarling, and it will stop. Again, you will put the key and you will try to start, right? Straining, snarling sound will be there again, like I have given to you. So this clearly explains us, gives the imagination, not only for us, but also Sonali. The snarling sound shows us this is not going to work. We are going to fail again. Because she thought that she survived, right? She thought that she survived, but now she's thinking that no, our last chance is also gone. So the snarling, straining sound effect is also very good examples for auditory imagery. Auditory imagery, right? So we have seen two examples for auditory imagery. Now you can clearly understand what you mean by auditory imagery and understand that type of auditory imagery, especially when it comes to short stories, right? So auditory imagery is a very powerful technique, but we discuss that most of the time. We discuss that especially in poetry, but here I have taken but here we have used this in short story, right? So that is called auditory imagery. Then we come to the next literary technique, which is known as dramatic quality. The dramatic quality, this is also a very important literary technique when it comes to poems as well as short stories. In a drama, the word dramatic comes from the word drama. What do you mean by drama? Certain characters will pop up on the stage and they will show their performance, and you will look at them and you will get the idea, okay, the character is delivering the dialogue, right? That is called drama, right? But in poetry, right, we have characters but we don't have a stage. We have the dialogues, but we can't hear them. We have the dialogues, but we can't hear them, right? When it comes to short stories, we have the story, we have to read it, we have the characters, we have the dialogue, but drama should be made from your mind. So what should help you? What should help you for that? That is called imagery. Visual imagery, tactile imagery, auditory imagery, olfactory imagery. You can use imagery for that, right? So imagination should be built up by yourselves, right? In poems and in short stories and in novels, right? I think you can understand. So dramatic quality means after reading a poem, after reading a short story, if you can create the certain incident or certain background or so, a certain act in your mind as a drama, as a film, that is called dramatic quality. In Sinhala literature, we call natyochita avastha. Natyochita avastha, right? So dramatic meaning refers to the ideas and stories that the audience understand from watching a dramatic performance. If the readers can visualize them after reading a poem or a short story, we call the situation is dramatic. right? So in most of the short stories that we have are dramatic techniques, especially if you take Lumber Room by Hector Hugo Munro, the way that Aunt fell into the water tank and the dialogue between Aunt and the Nicholas is highly dramatic, right? And if you take Sangakkara's story, the way the terrorists got together and how they shot at the bus, when the Sangakkara is explaining that to the audience, it is highly dramatic, right? So dramatic stories, dramatic quality can be seen. And here also, we have seen some dramatic quality where the situation is presented to us like a drama. A powerful, powerful mental pictures will be created inside our mind. Now see the example which I have taken in red color. It is shown to you on the screen. The Jeep was in water then. Suddenly, all this water inside the Jeep, water sloshing over our knees. Where did this water come from? I didn't see those waves get to us. This water must have burst out from beneath the ground. What is happening? The Jeep moved forward slowly. I could hear its engine straining, snarling. We can drive through this water, I thought. Even in the most desperate time, Sonali had the idea that she can survive, right? We all are human beings. We are like that. At the last moment, even though we explain that we don't like to live, this is impermanent, everything will be destroyed. Even at the last moment, even if you have a cancer, even if you have any kind of disease, until the last moment, we all wanted to live. We all wanted to live, right? So she also wanted to live and she also wanted to survive. That is the only hope that she had. But here, see how she explains that. How the water came from the ground, inside the ground, right? Because they thought that they survived. No water can be seen, but the water came inside the ground, according to her. So one can imagine what kind of situation was happening and how the safari Jeep tumbled over and how water came inside the Jeep and they didn't have any chance of surviving. And later on in this incident, you can clearly realize if you have read the book, Sonali and Steve took her children on top of their shoulders in order to give some kind of more time them to breathe. They knew that they are going to die, but at the last moment, they wanted to keep their children on top of their shoulders because at the end of the day, the most valuable thing that the parents had, their children. So they tried to keep them on top of their shoulders, but unfortunately, they also died and Sonali survived, right? So this is the situation where we call dramatic quality. There are a number of instances, incidents or else examples we can give for the concept of dramatic quality, right? So that is another literary technique that we can find from the story. Right, my dear children, then we are moving to the themes of the story. These are the basic themes. Now, when it comes to themes, your answers will be always based on themes, right? Your answers will be always based on themes if you are writing from literature, not from the language part. So if you are using language, the previous explanations which I have given can be used by yourself if you are writing answers for the language. But when it comes to literature, you can clearly understand the literature can be changed. Literature questions can be changed accordingly, but that you have to always think about the themes based on, and most of the questions will be targeted on according to the theme that you have studied, which is shown in the story, and according to that only you will be writing your answers, right? So what are the basic themes that had here? Human suffering and endurance. What do you mean by endurance? Endurance means your ability to start again, your ability to accept the challenges, and your ability to challenge them even after you scattered into small pieces. If you have that grit and stamina to stand up again, which is known as your endurance, power of endurance, or else we can use the word resilience, right? We can use the word resilience as well. Human behavior in a crisis situation, how people behave in a crisis situation, how people think about their relationships in a crisis situation, what kind of natural behavior change can be seen when it comes to their natural behavior can be seen when it comes to a crisis situation, especially a natural disaster, unexpected natural disaster. So we are moving to that and we are going to discuss about that. Right. Human suffering and endurance. I have taken the examples from the book. The red color quotations will be very important to you because if you by heart them, as you can see here, you can write your answers quite profoundly. And you can explain your answer quite well. If you studied all these red color quotations, then it will give a certain clear idea for you how to go through with this. Then I saw Steve's face. I would never seen him like that before. A sudden look of terror, eyes wide open, mouth agape. He saw something behind me that I couldn't see. I did not have time to turn around and look. So this is the place where the Jeep tumbled and Sonali and her husband faced into the suffocative situation. At that time, Sonali explains what kind of fear and terror that she saw on Steve's face, which is a clear example for human suffering. At the same time, Steve saw something behind Sonali that can be a huge wave, but unfortunately, as a husband, he couldn't explain that, because he was already fallen into the water and he didn't have any chance of surviving. So he doesn't have any chance of surviving Sonali as well. So this problem occurred for both people. The words here that the author has used also explains about the human suffering, words like terror and Steve's face, and it was full of terror and full of suffocation, and the facial expressions, eyes wide open, mouth agape, so no chance at all for survival. So she saw that human suffering. These are the traumatic experience that brought a lot of pain and agony to her life. Then the second example, which I have taken from the last paragraph of the extract, pain, that was all I could feel. There am I, something was crushing my chest. I am trapped under the Jeep. I thought I am being flattened by it. So the pain that Sonali went through at that moment is also explained here. So it is a very good example for human suffocation, how they suffered. And we have a lot of examples here, but I didn't use them here. You can take another example of mental suffering when Sonali explains that we forgot Archie and Sia, which is a clear example that inside, even though she thought that she did the correct thing, inside her mind, she always thought that she has the guilty conscience, right? She had the guilty conscience. She personally believes that because of her fault only, she couldn't, survive. She didn't have any chance to save her parents because of her problem or because of the things that she did, right? So, and I have explained here, as you can see on the screen, above quotations are best examples for a physical suffering undergone by Sonali and her husband. These quotations furthermore brings out suspense and terror to the story, as I have explained to you. So these two quotations can be taken as very powerful quotations to explain about the human suffering and endurance. Let's take about the endurance next, in the next slide. So what do you mean by endurance? I have explained that here. The capability of a strained body and mind to recover after deformation caused especially by compressive stress is known as endurance or resilience, right? Going after a very suffocative experience after losing each and everything that you have in life to stand up again, you should have a certain power in your life, because most of the people, they give up. Even Sonali gave up herself. Why? She thought of giving up. She thought of giving up, and she decided to suicide, but because she lost the resilience. But later on, she identified that, no, I have to live. I have to tell this story to the people. Other people should get to know about this, and the audience should be aware of this. And then her piece of literature became something very popular among the audience, right? Irrespective of giving up her life, her valuable life as an economist, as an author, as an experienced woman, she wanted to do something for the society. She wanted to express the complexity of human mind to society. So she wrote a book. So resilience can be seen in her character. The capability of strained body and mind to recover the after deformation caused especially by compressive stress is known as endurance or resilience. There can be a question like this for your ordinary level examination sometimes. How can you explain about the resilience and endurance of Sonali in the story, The Wave? Comment on the statement with relevant examples. There can be a question like that, right? The resilience and endurance, because we always talk about selfishness and selflessness, but we don't talk about the resilience and the endurance. I'm going to discuss that as well in this presentation. Even a hazardous situation, Sonali's capability of resilience and endurance is beyond explanation. As a woman, as a mother, she strives against all the forces in order to safeguard her family. Very important. Huh? I think you can read this. This is where we have to give her our credit. Following quotations are examples for that. So see the quotations which I have taken from the book and refer to them. And it shows clearly what kind of woman is Sonali. As a woman, as a mother, as a wife, she strives against all the forces in order to safeguard her family. Right? That is the most important thing. From the very beginning of the story, can you see, she was the one who noticed the situation. At that time, Steve was inside the washroom. right? Nobody understood the danger around them, right? She was the first one to notice because she is a mother, right? She always think about the protection of her family. So she was the one to notice that on the very first time, right? Then as a mother, how she took her children and she ran away, and how she tried to save them even after knowing that she's going to die, even at the last moment, how she tried to save her children. So this is called resilience, right? This is called resilience. At the last moment, even when the GP stumbled and filled with water, how she thought that, okay, I'm going to save my children. We have a chance. We have a chance here, right? So we will be safe. At the until the last moment, she believed in surviving. But unfortunately, she was the only one to survive. Then the example I have taken here, Steve and I lifted the boys as high as we could. As I have explained to you, the last moment. Steve held Vic, I held Mal. Their faces above the water, the tops of their heads pressing against the Jeep's canvas hood, our hands tight under armpits, under their armpits. So they kept their children on top of their shoulders in order to give a certain time period, a certain extra time period in order to breathe, right? Knowing that they are going to die. This kind of sacrifice can be only done by parents, especially when it comes to a mother, right? Even Steve followed the actions done by Sonali. So as a character, Sonali is a sacred or else a kind of a character with a lot of caliber and resilience. This is the best example that we can take for that. Then the way that they ran away and how she kept her children to her. I was ahead of Steve. I held the boys each by the hand, right? Give me one of them. Give me one of them. Father is shouting, right? Father is shouting, you give me one of them, I will take them. Steve shouted, reaching out, but I didn't. But I didn't. As a mother, she never trusted, even at that time, she never trusted her husband as well. She never trusted her husband as well. Not because she doesn't have the trust issues. But here, it explains the love that a mother had, right? The love that mother had. She always believed that the protection will be there to my children when they are with me, only with me. So she gave up her own parents because she wanted to save her children, right? What kind of tough decision is that? Do you think that she's an inhuman character? No, Puta. She's not an inhuman character. That was the love that she had. And sometimes you have to take hard decisions, right? Sometimes you have to take hard decisions, even now, even if they are hurtful, right? You have to take that kind of decisions, right? So there is no hard and fast rule about that. You have to go through with that. But I didn't. That would have slowed us down. We had no time. We had to be fast. I knew that, but I did not know what I was fleeing from. I didn't give my children to my husband even because I thought that it will make us late. And I had the problem of protection of them. So I love them both equally. So I wanted to keep them safe. This is kind of endurance or the resilience or the caliber, or else we call the grit and stamina that she had until the last moment to keep her children safe as a mother, as a woman. Then those are the two quotations which I have taken, and we have the other theme here, human behavior in a crisis situation. So what are the what kind of human behavior we can see in a crisis situation? Immediate reactions, I have taken that. Selflessness of people and selfishness. Selflessness of people and selfishness. Right. So immediate reactions, right? How people immediately react to the situations when they got to know about the disastrous situations. Not only natural disasters, but also man-made disasters are there. How people take sudden decisions and how they change. How they change their voice, attitude, tone, actions and everything. Steve, you have got to come out now. Steve ran out of the bathroom trying his sarong. He looked outside. We didn't speak. I grabbed Vic and Mali and we all ran out the front door. I was ahead of Steve. I held the boys each by the hand. Right. So soon after she identified the danger, she suddenly reacted. She did not wait to collect all the shoes and clothes and everything that they had. She did not wait to call other people, and she did not took her mobile phone and took some photos of that. She suddenly reacted as a mother. Right. She suddenly reacted, and the reaction brought her survival. But unfortunately, she wanted to save her family members and family friends, but unfortunately she was not successful in that. So immediate human reactions can be seen when we face into sudden disastrous situations. Then the selflessness. This is very important and powerful and very objective rather quotation that we have to study. Anton leaned out the back to reach Beula and drag her up. When he couldn't, he jumped out. They were both lying on the gravel now. This is called selflessness. Now, Anton's wife is Beula, and she could not, when the jeep is moving, she was not able to grab the jeep tightly, and she fell down. And Sonali shouted at that time to stop the jeep, but the driver didn't listen. At the same time, Anton, as the husband, understood that Behula fell down, her beloved wife fell down. So without having any second thoughts, he also jumped out of the jeep in order to save Behula. This is called selflessness. You think about other people more than yourself. That was the best sacrifice that one can do. So it is one of the best examples that we can follow for the selflessness. Anton was ready to give up his life. He jumped out of the jeep knowing that, right? He jumped out of the jeep knowing that his life will be in danger. Definitely both people will die, but he didn't have any second thoughts of that. People who are ready to sacrifice their own life for the betterment of love, we call that real love, right? Even Nightingale and the Rose by Oscar Wilde, the Nightingale was ready to give its life for the betterment of love, for the betterment of true love, right? So that is the highest sacrifice that one can do in one's life, right? The most valuable thing that we have in our life is our own life. So if you are ready to sacrifice that, which means that you have something. Then the water was rising now, filling the jeep. It came up to our chest. Steve and I lifted the boys as high as we could. Steve had held Vic, I had Mal. Now, this is another example for selflessness. As parents, they never thought about their happiness or else their survival. They always wanted to keep their children safe, right? Any mother will do that. Any father will do that. This is also known as selflessness or else the sacrifice made by them in order to save their children. Right, in order to save their children, right? So that was the explanation given here for selflessness. I have taken those examples for selflessness. Right, so those are the basic things that I have to discuss. And apart from that, we have some, target questions. Right. We will discuss about the target questions as well. Right. So when it comes to target questions, right, we are going to, we discussed about selflessness and we are moving to selfishness now. Can you see the screen, children? Can you see the screen? Please give me a message. Can you see the screen, guys? I didn't get the message still. I think you can see the screen. Right, okay. So now we are moving to selfishness. Previously we discussed about selflessness. Now we are going to discuss about selfishness. If you have any questions, you can ask Buddha regarding this. Okay, wait, still not visible. Right, can you see that now? Right, okay, Afra. Now we will move on. Now when it comes to selfishness, we can argue in that format as well. This is called selfishness of Sonali's character. In that format also we can argue. If you are coming to that perspective, again, we can argue that that is not selfishness. That is called actually the love that she had towards her children. So we can argue in both ways. So we will try to, understand that about that as well. Now here, I did not stop for my parents. I did not stop to knock on the door of my parents' room, which was next to ours. On the right, as we ran out, I did not shout to warn them. I did not bang on their door and call them out. As I ran past, for a splintered second, I wondered if I should, but I could not stop. It will stall us. Now, this is one of the famous quotations. Actually, it shows us about the situation of Sonali's character, where she didn't inform her parents, actually. Even though she wanted to inform them, she didn't inform them because she thought that make them late. It will make them late. So she decided not to inform anyone about this, and she ran away. So most of the time, one may say that she should inform her parents about this, but she didn't. But it is up to people to decide. But in your book also it says this can be taken as something done by Sonali, which is something very bad, and she did not inform about her parents. But if she informed her parents, that they could have at least saved. Even Sonali had that idea. That is why she cried in the story, saying that the Archie and Sia did not came with us. That is what she said, right? So having that idea, we can clearly realize Sonali also wanted to save them, but unfortunately she thought about her family. So this can be taken as an example for selfishness. And the second one, the second example which I have taken, they both were lying on the gravel, but I did not call out to the driver to wait for them. He was driving very fast. He is right. I thought, we have to keep moving. Soon we will be away from the hotel. Now here, the example is where she explains that the first time when Behula fell out from the jeep, she wanted to stop the jeep. She asked to stop the jeep because she thought that they should try to save Behula, because she is one of her family friends. But soon after, when driver continued, she thought that that's not the case. We want to save ourselves. We want to survive themselves. So we have to take tough decisions. And she never decides to stop. This again shows us some kind of selfish behavior in Sonali. So these two examples are very important to explain you about the selfishness and how she behaved in two different situations. But again, as I have explained to you, it is up to you to decide whether she has taken the correct decision or not, right? But here in your book, in the extract, it shows as selfishness. But in one point of view, we can say like that. But on the other point of view, we can clearly realize they have taken that decision in order to save their own family, right? Right. So we will move on to the next one. We are moving to target questions. So before coming to the target questions, if you have any questions, you can ask. Participants. So if you have any questions, you can raise your questions, then we can discuss them. Do you have any questions? You can put me a message. If you have any questions before moving. Right. Okay. Then we are moving to the target questions. My first question I have taken from the Wave is, the story Wave brings out both selfishness and selflessness of human beings discussed with examples from the text. Now let's take the examples and let's try to discuss. So I have given the basic information here. The novel Wave by Sonali Dharaniyagala presents the author's firsthand experience of the destructive tsunami which took away the lives of her British husband, her two children, and her parents at one stroke, leaving her alone in the world. Right? Wave charts the tortured year since Dharaniyagala was forced to face the impossible truth. The novel also brings out both the selfishness and selflessness of human beings, especially at moment of danger. So this behavior can be seen when it comes to disaster situations or the sudden and sudden situations. When they become panic, they behave like this. So we can't blame anyone here. So this is the behavior that we can see from them when it comes to disaster situations. The story begins with the narrator's observation of the unusual behavior of the sea, which is poised for a deadly attack. Very soon, the waves begin charge and churn, giving them hardly any time to escape. She, however, manages to call her husband and her children and rush out of the scene with them, only to be trapped by the unrelenting waves later. So she tried her level best to survive. Let's see what happened. It's while she rushes out of the hotel that she suddenly remembers that she did not knock out at the door of her parents' room. I did not stop for my parents, she writes. I did not stop to knock on the door of my parents' room, which was next to ours. I did not shout to warn them. So this is the example which I have discussed with you, and I have used that here to show the selfishness. She has pushed her parents to the fingers of her heart in her frantic struggle to escape. Although she regrets about it, we can see a tinge of selfishness here. It is natural that her children and husband were uppermost in her mind at that time. Fear can make us selfish, especially when we face a life-threatening situation. Also, when her friends' parents are left behind by the jeep, racing her family away from water. She doesn't call out to the driver to wait for them. He is right. She remembers thinking, the second quotation which I have used, we have to keep moving. This also shows a certain selfishness of the narrator, whose sole concern was the safety of her own children and the husband. But the karma was such that she wanted to save her children, but unfortunately she lost her children, her family members, as well as her parents and her husband, right? So this is called the circle of karma affected to her, right? While Sonali and her sons and her husband were making off a safari jeep, Orlanta's mother Behula falls out of the jeep, but nobody volunteers to pick her up and save her life. The narrator says, I did not call out the driver for wait for them at that time. They were concerned with their own lives rather than others. This also brings out the selfishness of the human beings at times of danger to a certain extent. However, Anton jumps out of the jeep and tries to help her to get up with great difficulty. This shows selflessness and sacrifice of human beings even at the risk of their own lives. I have explained that the behavior of Sonali shows us the selfishness. At the same time, the sacrifice of Anton clearly shows us the selflessness. Thus, the story wave shows dramatically the selfishness and selflessness of human beings at times of danger, though the actions of Sonali, the narrator, and those who are near and dear to her, and it leaves us pondering about how we could have reacted to the situation if we had faced the same situation. That is very important. That is why I have explained to you, you can tell number of things, Sonali is selfish, Sonali is like this and all, but just imagine putting those shoes into you and think about the situation, what you are going to do. Right? If you are in the same situation, you will realize that you will act in the same way, or rather in a much more extreme manner. Right. So I am moving to the second target question. This is about the question, wave is a family tragedy. Right? Wave is a family tragedy. Discuss. Right? That was my question. In her memoir, Wave, Sonali Dharaniyagala shares the true story of the tsunami in Sri Lanka that killed her husband, two sons and parents. As the only one in her family who survived the wave, Dharaniyagala fought through her grief and depression to find a new identity for herself. Her story covers a period of 7 years as she tries to make sense of what happened and learn to deal with her grief. 7 years. It can be also considered as a family tragedy. First and foremost, it's her own family that was destroyed by the tsunami. That is number one. That is why I am explaining this is a family tragedy. Her whole family died due to tsunami disaster. Her husband and two sons all perished in the disaster. What do you mean by perished? Died, vanished, right? The tragedy robbed her of all the happiness and joy of her life and drove her to the brink of suicide. The extract dramatically presents her frantic efforts to save herself and her family. Before the tsunami struck, they were relaxing in the hotel, totally unaware of the looming danger. Sonali, however, realizes the danger and rushed from the scene as soon as possible, only to be ambushed by the deadly tsunami on the way. A day one will never forget. A day that will forever be etched into the minds of mankind. The day that the sea came for so many innocent and unsuspecting people. A day that changed the course of so many lives. A day that tore so many lives asunder. It's a tale narrated by a wife about her husband. A tale narrated by a mother about her children. These things are very important. Nah? That is why we are dealing, that is why we are explaining this is known as a family tragedy. Why? Because it is a tale narrated by a mother about her children. It is a tale narrated by a wife about her husband. A tale narrated by a lover about her love. Thus, there are so many facets about family in one book. It is without a doubt a tale close to the hearts of so many who lost so much in the 2004 tsunami. So many untold tales of the countless thousands who were left behind to grieve and given voice by Sonali Dharaniyagala in this book. That is why her life is so much valuable, right? There can be thousands and thousands of stories which are very similar to this or else much more worse than this. But nobody wrote a book about that, right? Nobody wrote a book about that. But Sonali gave a voice to them, right? So their untold story can be seen in this book. Their untold tragedy, their untold, emotions can be seen in this book. Steve, Vikram and Mali are lost to her forever, yet she learns to live. She learns that by holding them in her heart and cherishing her moments with them, she is able to give them life. She is able to go on, right? That was the idea. Then, most will see Wave as a harrowing book, a book that will leave one shocked and sad, a tale that will leave some despondent even. So we can see Wave as a story of love and tragedy, the all-encompassing love of a mother for her beloved children, the unending love of a daughter of her parents, the undying emotions of love and passion of a loving wife for a husband and one true love. It's truly a family story, although she was left with no family in the end. Right, from that we will wrap up the presentation and you will have a second version of this in the upcoming week, and I am going to discuss about Lumber Room because you have 1 hour left. So we will discuss about the Lumber Room as the full story. Till then, thank you so much for participating in this. If you have any questions, you can always ask the questions through WhatsApp. So within the next week, I will explain you, I will give you the dates about the next presentation, Lumber Room. We will do another presentation about that. So thank you so much for participating for the presentation. If you have any questions, you can always put your questions through my WhatsApp and you can ask the questions. Thank you so much. We have discussed two target questions and we have discussed all the literary techniques that which are there and the themes and the background of the story and how to answer the questions, right? So the next presentation will be Lumber Room, joining with that. Yes, you will get the PDF of this soon after I ended the presentation, right? So thank you so much for participating. I will give the link most probably within next week. Thank you so much for participating for this and have a nice day.